No, so I will share the screen. So you are able to see the screen, right?
Yes.
Yes, sir. So anyway, so before you see, I start if all right, right? So I welcome you all once again for the second class, okay, in this CE3050. So if you see a quick recap, say, like what we did, you know, the last class. So I have already told you the curriculum, okay, how we have planned the curriculum at our IIT for steel, okay. So there are not only this course, so you have two other courses. So if you do this only, you know, you will become a very good, you know, as a designer in steel. Of course, the first two itself are sufficient, but this will give you some additional information, you know, about research and how, you know, the advanced things in steel design, okay. So this is a core, the elective and other things also I have told you. And the most important thing what you should understand is the expectation is after you do this course, you should be, you know, able to do the member design, okay. So this is the main objective of this course. You should be able to design your own steel beam, steel column, steel beam column, or you know, whatever you followed, right? Base plate, you know, tension member, compression member, that you should be able to do, okay. So that is how this course is planned. So the complete design will be in the next semester course itself, because that requires a lot of integrity and other things also, okay. So I have already shown you the syllabus, what we are going to do. So whatever is available online, so same thing we are also going to follow here itself. And then, you know, so I have shown you what is that we are going to design, you know, the laced column, battens, splices and other things also, which we are going to study as a part of this course itself, okay, beams and other things also. So now textbooks I have shown you, and as already I told you, these are like mandatory, okay, the IS course. Without IS 800, you know, and then this IS handbook once, you will not be able to do this steel design. So you have to keep these things, you know, with you during examinations and other things also. Otherwise, you know, it will be very difficult to solve the problems, okay. And of course, apart from these two, we should require some other codes, that is, you know, to find out dead load, live load, wind load, earthquake load, say. Some other codes are there. Soft copies are available, so you can go through those documents also. And you can buy any of these textbooks also, I have told you in the last class, okay. Now the grading pattern also was discussed in the last class. And finally, say, so we came to this, what do you mean by structural design, okay. So this also we discussed in great detail last class. So as already I told you, structural design is, you know, two things are there. One is, you know, artistic invention, and other thing is dimensioning, okay. So now in, but you know, last class some of you pointed out, okay, nowadays this creation of structural forms, say. So here, you know, the architect, nowadays you followed, right, they do this, the creations, okay. So how, you know, what type of a structure, what should be its form architecturally, you know, whether it is very nice or something like that, architects take this one. So this is where the engineers, you know, comes into picture, that is in the dimensioning. But of course, you know, sometimes, you know, architect may give whatever they like, but sometimes it may not be able to, we will not be able to design. So once again, structural engineer, you know, he comes and tells you, say, whether it is you have to redesign or something also, okay. But finally, when a structure collapses, say, so who will be in jail, architect or engineer? See, in our civil engineering, say, you have designed some, so who will be below bars? Engineer only. Architect will escape, okay. Because, you know, the safety and other things, you know, that is a job of an engineer, okay. And you please see, these are the words, okay, stability, so the structure has to be stable, serviceability, suitability, and then this is a new word, sustainability. Previously, it was not there. In the last 10 years, people have started, you know, adding sustainability, and maybe in future, say, some more words may get, you know, added up also, okay. So, our engineering job is essentially, you see, the dimensioning. So, this is what we do in design, okay. So, analysis course. So given a load, you will find out the internal force, bending moment, shear force and other things. So design means, you know, essentially you will find out the dimensions. Okay. So what are the design variables? So what are the design variables which are required? So if you want to calculate design variables, say, suppose if you are using a tension member, okay. So some of you pointed out it, length, breadth and this. So everything depends on sigma, the stress. So sigma is equal to, you see, P by A, all of you know. So load is known. And sigma is also known based on the yield stress of the material. So where you want to take the failure or something. So if you do all these things, say, so the only unknown is A, that is the area of the member. So that is a design variable. So in tension members. Now similarly in compression members also, what extra thing you have to do for a compression member? What is that you have to worry? What are the most important design variables for columns? See, if you are designing a column, so what is that you are more worried? So the formula, stress formula will be simply P by A only, okay? But what other extra information you require when you are doing compression? See, for design of columns, say, which one? No, load is fine. Buckling, yes. So buckling depends on what? What is the thing which governs buckling?
Slenderness ratio.
So this also plays, you have to do additional work, okay, for design of a column. So you have to check the slenderness, you know, the maybe the instead of sigma y, say, you may have to use lower, you know, the it may fail before yielding itself. So this becomes, you know, your design variable. Suppose if you are designing a beam, like last class I told you, what is the stress inside a beam? Stress, so if from your simple bending formula, say, my by I, so you can write this as M by Z, okay. Oh, so Z is nothing but, you see, last class I already told you. What is Z? Now, what do you mean by Z? Last class I told you, right? What is the Z indicates what?
Section modulus.
Section model. It is a very, very important thing because your, so bending moment will be known for a beam, okay? And sigma y also will be known, the yield stress or whatever things are known. So now the design variable for beams is, you know, Z actual. So if Z is more, the beam has, you know, more strength actual, okay? So that is how we see, we calculate, you know, we are all these things. Now for torsion formula, say, what is the torsion formula? What is the stress inside in a torsion? Sigma, what is the stress for a torsion? See, torsion formula, say. So what is the torsion formula you do? So what is the torsion formula? So what is the stress inside a torsion?
PR by J.
PR by J. Okay. So you will be having, you know, the torque, whatever torque you have done. So TR by J. So what is the most important design variable here? So torque is known to you. Sigma is also known based on yield stress or some other failure you can select. So now here, you know, you have to select R. And then you have to select J, that is a polar moment of inertia. So similar to section modulus, we can also have in a Z by J by R itself. So these are the design variables. So structural design essentially involves, you know, calculating these dimensions. So area, length, width and others, then slenderness ratio, and then you see section modulus. So this is what you see, we do it exactly in the design. Okay. So this is the job of a structural engineer. So now, but here the main problem is, you know, you will have multiple solutions are there actually, okay? So you can solve the same problem with variety of cross sections. You can solve with I section, you can have a rectangular section, circular section with same area, or maybe with same section modulus, so which one to use. So, you know, so this has to be, the decision making becomes very important, and finally, you see, the cost becomes, you know, based on that also we do this design, okay? So this is what essentially structural design. So structural design means essentially obtaining, you see, the dimensions, area, slenderness, section modulus and others. Can anybody tell me what's the section modulus for a rectangular cross section? What is the moment of inertia for rectangular cross section? BH cube by 12. So what will be section modulus? What will be Y? Where stress will be maximum? For rectangular cross section, that flexural stress you would have drawn, right, in your mechanics of materials. So this is how the flexural stress distribution will be maximum at the ends. Okay, so what will be the section modulus? So if H is the depth of the beam, say, so BH cube by 12, you know, you have told the moment of inertia. So now H will be, what will be Y? The maximum will be H by 2, so 2 by H comes. So section modulus, say, for rectangle is, you know, BH square by 6 itself, okay? So like this you can calculate, and these are all very, very important, you know, the design variables, okay? So this is what essentially structural design about. Now in design, say, most of you would have studied this also. like whenever you want to do a design, say, like I'm just showing, you know, this is Northeast India. So, you know, our government, you followed, right, is spending a lot of money, okay, to develop Northeast, of course, strategy, other things are there. So, have you heard about this Majoli in Northeast India? See, anybody is there from Northeast? No. Majoli, have you heard this name Majoli near Jorhat, you know, it comes, there is one specialty is there near Majoli. What is the main?
River island.
It is a river island. I think it is the largest river island, or you know, maybe in Guinness book something is there. Okay, so you can Google it and you can find out. So our government is building a bridge here. Okay, so this is a bridge, you know, which we are, they are going to build up, and the zoomed up version is here. So this is a new bridge, you know, which is coming, you know, connecting this Jorhat and then this Majoli. And of course, I am the seismic consultant anyway for this bridge itself. So now how do the thing starts? The government takes a policy like I want to build a bridge or something like that. So once they decide, say, okay, so many companies, what they do is they do this conceptual design with the initial stage. Okay, so they do what type of structural forms, you know, which should be nowadays, you know, green, something they are telling it, green thing. Then, you know, it should be more or less linked with the culture and other things. So they decide, and depending on the difficulties, what type of structural form you require. So this is, I think they have come to, they will design a steel bridge there. Okay. So what they do is, you know, so L&T, then all other companies say. So they do first thing is, you know, a conceptual design they will do actually. Okay. So like, you know, what type of form they will calculate approximately, you know, what material choice, and then simplify model they do. Then the loads they evaluate, and they will obtain trial dimensions. And finally, you know, they calculate this cost. Okay. So because in design also, you know, whatever you may say, civil engineering, this and that, but at the end of the day, say money matters a lot. Okay. The economy and so many things are there. So we do approximate analysis and cost estimate. So this they will carry out. So this starts our tendering process. Okay, so they will know how much it has to be tendered, or you follow, no, the amount required or something. So companies, they bid a lot. So once a company gets this, you know, a project, say, then they will do this detailed, you know, a preliminary design. So all details are defined, you know, final modeling, analysis, everything they do. And finally, it goes to documentation, drawing cost, you know, and then contracts and other things are prepared. So these are the basic three steps in design. Okay, that is how any structure, say, design gets carried out. Anyway, so now we are going to design, you see, the member design for these type of bridges actually. Okay, so this general, there's the overall view about design. But now here I just wanted to mention, you see, in RCC design, say, so RCC design, you know, you can cast any specimen you like, any shape you like, you know, at the field itself. But when it comes to steel design, say, who controls, you know, the steel design in the country? Yeah. So who is the one in steel design? So who is the major, you know, the player in the, you know, you followed, right, in this entire steel design? Engineer or architect or somebody else? See, when you say RCC, say, okay, engineer and of course architect or something you can say, but in steel design, say, who is the main, you know, who has that control? See, in steel design, who is the one who controls the steel design?
Engineer.
No, engineer is fine, but you design, engineer is just like a clerk, okay? Given, you know, you have to find out the dimensions only. But who controls the steel design, essentially? So not an engineer. The main players are companies, okay, which manufacture the steel specimens. You followed, right? Like Tata Steel, say, because they only will produce, right? You may design and say, I want this type of I section, say. So Tata Steel, the, let us say, they are not manufacturing that itself. Then how are you going to do? So it becomes a problem. So companies, you know, they, you know, cast these specimens. Tata Steel, no? I section, L section. So they manufacture these things, and you know, you are in the hands of you know, them. So if they give this type of things, you know, we have to do with those specimens itself. So Tata Steel is there, then JSW Steel. So these are the big companies. So they control this design. So the production of steel, say, so that is in their hands. Okay, so. Of course, engineer is the main player. That's a different issue. But companies also play a very, very major role. You know, many Arcelor, Mittal Steel, you would have studied. Okay, so these are the big players, and they control this even our steel structures also. So this you have to just you know keep it in mind. Okay, so now let us. So we have seen the design. You know what is meant by design and others. So now the question comes: why we have to use steel as a building material? Okay, so now we should have a broad you know perspective. Okay, why we have to use steel as a building material? So now you know you would have studied in your you know I think some sixth class or seventh class, you know, that Big Bang theory, then how things have formed, you know, all the planets, solar system, galaxy, everything you would have studied. Now if you see, the interesting thing is, if you see the most common elements in our galaxies, a Milky Way galaxy or whatever, so now you can see the first thing is hydrogen, actually, okay, which is abundant in our you know the galaxy or whatever in the universe. And finally the fourth is you followed, right? 1, 2, 3, 4. Fourth is, you know, carbon, which is you know abundant in our universe. Then among that is the sixth one turns out to be iron itself. So iron is, you know, abundant in our galaxy. Okay, this iron material. So steel anyway is a combination of iron and carbon. Of course, majority is iron itself. And if you see our Earth itself, the planet, you can see 32.1% of Earth is composed of iron ores only. Okay, and of course other things are there, small you know things itself are there. And so now these details you can get from you know the Google itself. So when things are abundant, say, so the question is, you followed, right? We can use these things to build you know whatever structures we want, because steel is not only required for you know the structures, but even you know mechanical, you know, cars, you followed, right? Aircrafts, you know, the missiles or whatever, the spacecrafts or everything. So you, there also you require this you know steel itself. So steel production, say, is something you know you have to do, and maybe you see it is the future itself. Okay, because now I think you know people are going to Mars, Moon, and other things are there, say. So they are also trying to do this type of minings are there. Okay, so recently, you know, there are some asteroids are there which are made up of pure iron also. So these companies are also trying to mine, you know, iron from, you know, these things also. Okay, so that is how, you know, the future is going. So because of this one, you know, the steel is becoming very, very popular, you know, nowadays. See, in olden days, say, these Mars, Venus, or Jupiter, or Saturn, these were astronomical objects, we say. Okay. So astronomical objects means, you know, you followed, right? We know where Jupiter, you know, what is the periodicity, you know, from here you used to watch in telescopes and then find out all kinds of the thing. Then this Jyotishya, you followed, right? If Jupiter comes or Saturn comes, my life is gone. So something like that we used to do. But now, you know, people are sending probes there. So now these are not, no more astronomical objects. They're all geological objects. Because, you know, with the specimens they are, you know, taking from these planets also. So once this geology of these planets are known, so you will find out that there is a lot of iron ore is there here, and we can mine it and we can build, you know, the steel itself. So that is, you know, the reason why you followed, right? Steel is much popular, you know, compared to other things itself, because it is widely available in, you know, the universe itself. Okay. And now if you see our history, say, okay, so like our ancient people also. So, you know, Indus Valley civilization or Greek civilization also, they have found out, like, you know, some small knives or something like that in very old. Then, but most of the steel structures, say, this iron and wrought iron and other things, cast iron, so many things, you will find mostly in the Europe, I think. Okay. So in Europe, you will find lot of constructions, the steel constructions, wrought iron, you know, iron or cast iron, steel, all those things you'll find out in Europe. But in India, say, we don't see much, you know, constructions, you know, in steel. You followed, right? In India, if you see, lot of old temples are there. So we also have very great history. So if you see all the old temples in India, say, you will find, you know, they will be constructed with stones and, you know, other kind of a thing. You will not find this steel or iron, essentially. Okay, this is not widely used in our India. So can anybody tell us the reason why we don't use iron in our constructions, temples, essentially? So any of you know about why we don't use iron in construction of temples?
Sir, maybe higher humidity, so rusting may be faster.
Rusting may be fine. That is also a very good observation, what you have put, scientific. But you know, right, in our, for construction of temples, what is that we use? What is the standard, right, for construction of temples?
Stones.
So stone, a standard I'm talking, like our IS code is there, right? So for construction of temples, we have some standards, not Indian standards, some standards are there. What are those standards? Have anybody idea? No, tell me once again, I didn't hear. No, we have some books are there to design essentially temple, Agama Shastras. I don't know how many of you have heard, okay? So this is what you know, our construction is mostly based on. So you know, right, you would, I think there is a textbook NCRT book also got printed, Metallurgy in India, Old Metals. So we have, I think, some 7 metals of antiquity are there. Gold, silver, copper, you know, iron, tin, mercury, like that. We have lead and other things also. This is the one which one use. But our Agama Shastras say, they say that iron is an impure material. You followed, right? So they say it is an impure material. So they say that in during construction of temples are major, you know, important. This one, iron should not be used at all in our construction. So in our, that is why you see we don't see iron in many temples. Even I don't know the recent Ayodhya temples, the Ram Mandir, which is going to come up in Ayodhya, where L&T is doing the foundation, say. So we are doing that seismic and then, you know, the structural part we are checking. So there also we have a constraint. The constraint is, you know, we should not use, you know, iron in the entire construction, iron or steel. So steel should not be used in our construction of Ayodhya Ram Mandir also. You followed, right? So this, you know, it is restrict, say. So you have to use stones. You can use gold if you have a lot of money. You can use silver. Silver column you can build, gold columns you can use, but not, you know, the iron columns or steel itself. Even you should not use even RCC also. So FRP bar should not be used. So here the design is a big, you know, a challenge, because everything has to be done in steel, sorry, this rock and then, you know, other type of materials. So you accept this steel itself, okay? So that is why you see, you don't see much, you know, steel in the construction of temples in our India because of iron impure. I think one of you nicely pointed out, right? Rusting and other things, that could be one reason why our ancients told this as impure metal actually. I have no idea, okay? So anyway, that is, but most of the steel structures, if you want to see, you have to go to Europe, say. They have nice bridges, it seems, are there, you know, 17th century, 6th century, say. So they have a lot of these constructions. But in India also, all the steel is impure, say. But you will find out some archaeological, you know, wonders in our country itself. So can anybody tell us this post? What is this pillar?
Sanchi
Stupa. Sanchi Stupa. So where is this?
Sir, in Delhi. In Delhi.
Delhi. Where it is in Delhi?
Qutub Minar.
In Qutub Minar. So you know, right? This is an archaeological wonder. You know, steel wonder, they say. Okay, it is 7.2 meter long. And carbon dating shows somewhere around the 375 common era. It has been built by some king or something like that. Okay, Gupta dynasty or something. So this is a very, very interesting iron pillar in Delhi. So there are many, and it has no corrosion actually. Okay, you people can go and see also. Okay, so you know, many international people, even our Indians, you know, so he is a professor in IIT Kanpur, metallurgy professor. Okay, so many people, many international groups are there, many people have done work on this iron pillar, why it is not rusting, or what is the metallurgy, how they manufactured this at that time itself. So they found out, you know, this composition, carbon how much, silicon how much, you followed, right? Sulfur, phosphorus, manganese, you know, iron, you can see 99% they have used here. So what are the other materials, you know, they have used in, why it is not rusting. So that's a very, very interesting, you know, works have been carried out. There are several papers have been published, and some thesis also came up in studying this ancient, you know, the metallurgy, how the manufactured steel in those days itself. It's our archaeological wonder, okay? So if any of you wants to see, you know, you can go to Qutub Minar and you can see this pillar itself. Now, similarly, one more pillar is there in Madhya Pradesh, their Dhar iron pillar. Okay, so this is also a very famous thing, and that is the tallest pillar, some 13.2 meter long, okay, and it is some 11th century, it seems. But because it was so long, so they say during war it got broken into three pieces actually. Okay. So this pillar is also there, and this also, you know, people have studied the corrosion resistance of this Dhar pillar also. They try to find out, you know, even this the content, like, you know, how much is carbon, manganese, the metallurgy say. So they are not rusting also. So how did they manufacture, you know? So this type of research is also being carried out, you know, nowadays. And then this is also one more pillar, Kodachadri iron pillar, they say. Anybody know where is this place? Kodachadri. So where is this place located, Kodachadri? Have anybody idea about this pillar? In?
Western Ghats.
Somewhere in Western Ghats. The name itself says some Adri, Chadri, you followed, right? So these in Karnataka, you followed, right? So this is a tall, you know, iron pillar. So these also 8.7 meter long, some 6th century. Some temple is there. So, you know, these have, they have done some scaffolding and others. So this our IG cars, atomic energy people, they have done this metallurgy analysis. So there is a papers, you know, have been published in various journals. So they found out, like, you know, how this iron has been used, what is the content, what is the speciality. So this also, you know, they have done. So like this, you know, nowadays, you know, many people are carrying out research. If some of you are interested, say, on this, you know, ancient structures, iron, steel, you followed, right? Very nice structures are there. Now, these are the three which are very well known, but there are many places. There are some pillars even in Andhra, Ahobilam, you know, if you go to the Narasimhan, the temple, say. So there also, there is one iron pillar is there. So, but nobody has done any, you know, this type of work. So if some of you are interested, say, nearby your places also, you may see this ancient things itself. And if it is iron, say, so all the techniques are nowadays very well established. Okay, even in our IIT also, we have all the instruments. So some of you can do work for your projects or something. So it depends, you know, on your interest. Okay, so just if you are interested, you just find out these things. Okay, so fine. So this steel is not used in, you know, because iron is considered as impure. But, you know, there are some constructions still in India, and these are all metallurgy wonders, are, you know, they say, like, how they are without rust, they are, you know, still standing, you see, now also. But our structures are getting RCC, you know, 25, 50 years, you know, it gets old, but these structures are very old, but still, you know, giving a good thing itself. Anyway, so now if you see why iron, if you see this iron, say, it has very, very little, you know, the mechanical strength actually. Okay, so if these are all iron atoms or whatever you have, so what happens is, you know, they get easily sheared off actually. So, you know, so this is the reason why this iron has very, very little mechanical strength. So what one does in practice is we add, you know, more carbon actually. Okay, so these are the carbon atoms. You can see the yellow ones here. So once you add iron to this carbon to this iron set, so then automatically steel comes into picture actually. So the definition of steel is it is just an alloy of iron and carbon itself. But here one thing is, you know, when you add more carbon, say, so strength of the steel becomes very, very extremely high. It becomes very good, but its ductility, you know, it goes down. See, you know, right, in our world, say, everything is, you know, if you want something, nothing comes free for us. If you want something, you have to leave something. So if you want more strength, say, ductility, you know, goes away and the material becomes, you know, brittle, like concrete itself. So, you know, it just, you know, it becomes, you know, brittle kind of a material, brittle type of failure it shows. So there is some, so you have to have a balance between strength and ductility. Okay, so we will see we will see ductile and other things also later on. So now, so if you add more carbon, strength increases, but ductility goes down. So there is something like a balance which we have to do. So there is, so the balance is something like this. Okay. So they say that for structural steels, carbon content should be 0.12 to 0.25% only. So then, you know, you will get a steel which has good strength and as well as ductility also. So the definition of steel is, it is just an alloy of iron and carbon. This is the definition of steel. Now, of course, nowadays, as already I told you, people are adding, you know, some more materials also. You would have seen, right, Kodachadri pillar, even our ancient people also, instead of adding only carbon, say, they have adding manganese, you know, molybdenum, vanadium. There are several other chromium, nickel, copper also they have added. So this is one formula, carbon equivalent they say. Okay, so which tells you how much percentage of other materials you have added to iron, like carbon, manganese, chromium, molybdenum, vanadium, nickel, and then copper. So this is a typical formula which we use in to find out the carbon equivalent of steel. And if carbon equivalent is more, say, so when means, you know, if you are adding more of this material, it will get high strength, but you know, it becomes more brittle. And once it becomes a brittle, say, it will be welding also is a big you know, a problem. So if you want to connect this to some other members also, we have a problematic also. So more carbon means more strength but less weldability. If it is more or less carbon, say, the steel becomes a little less strength, but it becomes more ductile and you can even weld the material itself. Okay, so this is a carbon equivalent. This is a very, very famous you know, formula which is even used in our IS codes also to find out you know, what is the carbon equivalent for that grade of steel. So that's why, so once carbon goes and sits in these gaps, right? So as already I told you, you know, so this is shearing, say, the strength becomes very, very strong and steel gets its strength itself. Like as already I showed you, like for iron, say, you know, it has very little mechanical strength, but once you add this carbon and manganese or something, you know, so you will get this very good strength for the steel itself. So this is what they say. So steel is nothing but, you see, a solid solution of, you know, a carbon in iron itself. So this is how, you know, we define. So now this is how the steel is manufactured. You would have studied, I think, in your 10th or some class you followed, right? So you take iron ore, limestone, then coal, say, you dump here. Is a blast furnace you do. So you know, right, pig iron, you know, that comes here. And once that pig iron, say, we add oxygen actual, okay? So we add oxygen here to remove these impurities, to reduce the carbon and then impurities like silicon, manganese, phosphorus, and all those things, say. So to reduce impurities, we add oxygen. And finally, say, so we deoxidize. You add oxygen to remove the impurities. After that, you have to do deoxidization, we say, okay? So if you don't remove oxygen, say, so you will see bubbles actual, and then steel gets solidified. So you will see this type of uneven structures itself. So if oxygen content, say, in the final thing, if it is less than 30 ppm, we call as a fully killed steel actual. Okay, so this is a term is a fully killed means you have removed the full, you know, the oxygen itself. And if it is less than 150, say, so this is what we call as a, you know, semi-killed steel. So these are all metallurgical terms, or, you know, the companies say. So they do, they use these type of things itself. So killed means you have removed the oxygen. That is the meaning of this one. So complete deoxidization means fully killed. Semi-killed means, you know, little bit of oxygen things are there itself. So once you have this oxygen, you add and remove impurity, then you remove oxygen. So you will get all these specimens are there. So you send it to a mill and then you manufacture, you know, these I sections, angle sections, channel sections, say, which is a Tata Steel, JSW Steel. So they produce and they will sell it to you, these type of sections, which can be used for construction. So these are some metallurgical terms are there. No need to worry. See, the metallurgy of steel itself can be a full semester course. Okay. So, but anyway, for this course, you should know just some words. Ferrite. Okay. This is what, you know, you should know. What do you mean by ferrite? Also known as alpha iron also. This is a metallurgical name for this. So if it is 0.02% of carbon, very, very less carbon, we call this as, you know, ferrite. Then 6.67%, say, we call as cementite. Then perlite, this is a very most important thing we will be using. So 0.8%, say, we call this as a perlite. Then austenite is there. So 2% of carbon. These are just names, okay? So this name alpha iron, gamma iron. So same, gamma iron is also known as austenite also. Ferrite, this also is known as perlite. So these are cement. So these are all just metallurgical terms here in steel. And then this is how the different phases of iron. So as you increase the temperature, say, when it is less than 910 degrees, so it is like alpha, you know, ferrite. Then 910 to 1400, say, so austenite comes, then it becomes a ferrite, then it becomes a liquid, and then you see this becomes a gas. So these are melting points somewhere 1539 or something, where your solid steel, say, becomes it just, you know, it flows as a liquid itself, okay? So these are just some terms, you know, which you should know, okay? That is sufficient. And you know, you can see this microstructure also. Our electron microscopes are there. If you see steel, say, so this is how it comes. So this is 100% ferrite, okay? So which contains low carbon steel. Then this is a combination of ferrite plus perlite. So perlite means 0.8%, and we have already defined here. So perlite, you can see 0.8% of carbon. ferrite means, you know, 0.02% of carbon, very, very low itself. Okay. So this is like, you say 100% perlite. If it is a perlite plus cementite, how the microstructure looks like. But for our study, the mild steel, say, our building structure, so it is essential it has a ferrite plus perlite. So this is a microstructure which we are, you know, for our building. So perlite imparts, gives material strength because it has more carbon, and ferrite, say, which has less carbon, gives ductility. Okay. So this is the most important thing you should know. So ferrite, so steel means ferrite plus perlite. So ferrite means, you followed it, it is low carbon. So it gives low carbon means more ductile. Okay. Perlite means very high carbon means more strength, but less ductility. Okay. So this gives you ductility. The other one gives you, you followed right, this strength. So this is a very, very, you followed right, the important thing in, you know, this is our steel itself. So steel is essentially ferrite plus perlite. So, you know, one gives strength, other one gives ductility. So this is how, you know, they manufacture. So once it goes to mills, say, okay, so you dump these steel specimens. So automatically you can have, you know, the I sections, channel sections. So there are many mills are there. Even if you go to YouTube, you know, you can find how I sections are manufactured, you know. So some nice YouTube videos are there, how they do all these things itself. Now here also one more important thing you should see in steel is, if you want to increase the, you know, the strength of steel, say, people have done a lot of, you know, experiments, essentially metallurgy people, not civil engineering. So there is one famous Hall pitch equation is there. Okay. So which gives, you know, the strength of steel, say, as a function of, you know, some three parameters, where this is the most important parameter, that is the grain's diameter. Okay. So they say that if you want more strength, say, you can decrease the grain diameter. And then your grain diameter, say, it depends on, you know, what type of alloys, you know, as already I told you, carbon equivalent, you are adding some other material or whatever here, then the cooling rate, how fast you are cooling the steel. So if you fast accelerated cooling, you will get some type of strength. If you do slow heating, you will get some type of a strength, and, you know, so this is a very important formula. So the grain diameters, if I can decrease the grain diameter, I can get more strength also. So this is a formula which, you know, metallurgy people, you know, they use based on some theory itself. Okay. So now here, you know, one more important thing in steel is, some people, you know, they get confused. We will be using cast iron, you know, then wrought iron, then mild steel. Okay, these are this one itself. So three types of things are there. Sometimes people, you know, they think cast iron is also steel, wrought iron is also steel, that's a mild steel. But there are different issues. So cast iron, the definition is, you know, 2.5 to 4.5 carbon content. So the carbon content in steel decides. Okay. Whether this is the one which guides, okay. So 2.5 to 4.5% carbon is more. Then if it is 0.2% of carbon, say, we call it as a wrought iron. Then 0.1 to 1.1%, say. So this we call as, you know, the mild steel. That is our, you know, the building which we use for our construction of buildings. So if carbon content is more, say, what happens? What happens to its strength? So now among cast iron, wrought iron, and then, you know, this steel, say, which will have more strength?
Cast iron.
Now why?
Because it has high carbon content.
So high carbon means which one will be dominant, ferrite or perlite?
Perlite.
Perlite only. Okay. So now what is the disadvantage of more carbon? No.
Low ductility.
So ductility, no ductility. So if it is not ductile, so you can't weld also. You followed, right? So this is a problem. And now wrought iron strength will be low. You can see here there are some numbers are there. Compressive strength, tensile strength has been given here. So compressive strength is low. Okay. But you know what happens is, you know, it has it can you know, it is easily forged welding you can do. You followed. But another problem is it rusts more. When carbon content is more, say, no rusting happens actually. Okay. But if carbon content is low, say, because iron, the properties, it rusts. And of course, our mild steel also, it rusts actually, because carbon content is very, very low itself. So these, so cast iron is widely used in pipes. So these are all cast iron pipes. You would have seen, right, now many places, of course, nowadays people are going for concrete pipes itself. But if you see olden days or even some places now also, people use a cast iron for pipes because, you know, non-rusting properties. So they used it and it is very cheap actually, okay. And then wrought iron, say. So because the forging, you know, the welding and ductility is very important. So they still use to find out, you know, these chains, crane hooks I am showing here. So these are all wrought iron. Okay, still it is being used. If you go to our shipyard, say, so they will use these type of big chains and crane hooks. Still, you know, people are using this wrought iron things. And of course, mild steel means our reinforcement, RCC, you followed it, whatever, that is our building material. So these are three types of things. So though you should not get confused. Sometimes people think cast iron also has steel. Of course, all are iron and carbon only. So depending on the carbon contents, you can get variety of, you know, the products. And now this is also one more chart. So like up to 0.1%, okay, the steel we call as mild steel, that is our civil engineering, okay, steel sections, building, bridges, we all use, say. So our carbon content is 0.1% only. Then there is another medium carbon steel is there, 0.1, 0.2, they use for boiler, because as already I told you, right, steel is not only important for a civil engineer, but mechanical engineer for making cars, you know, aircrafts, you see. Many, n number of applications are there. So they use different types of steels, like high carbon steel, if you see, right? So it is used for your axe, cutlery, drilling, knives, punches, chisels, hammers, So it varies actually, okay? But anyway, in our civil engineering, sir, so this is the one which we are going to use for our construction. We don't use these type of, things for our constructions, okay? And this is the chemical composition of our mild steel. So this is given in our code IS, I think 2062 or somewhere you will find out. So this is our Fe410A. So this is what we regularly use in our constructions, okay? So Fe410A, so this is our IS code 2062. And the carbon equivalent, say, for our 0.23%, 1.5 manganese, all these things they are added. And carbon equivalent is, 0.42. So that is a combination of all these materials. And 0.41 and then 0.39. So these what is available in the market also nowadays. Okay. So if you want steels, if you go to any shop, you have to tell Fe410, A, B, C grades are there. Then there are also high strength also. Fe440, 540, 590 also. Can anybody tell me what is this number indicates? 410, 440, 510, what does it tell? What is this number?
Yield.
It is?
Yield strength.
Strength only, what strength it is? Yield strength or
yield
what else?
Strength.
Yield stress.
Yield stress. Okay, it is yield stress or what else it is? So it is not yield strength. Generally steel, this code is, if you see it's a stress strain curve, say, okay. So it goes yielding, then it comes, and then you will have like this actual, the stress strain diagram for steel generally. So now this 410 yield stress means somewhere here the yielding happened. It is F of Y, okay. But generally steel, say this 410, this corresponds to this one, the ultimate tensile strength. You followed it. So this is Fu or something, you see, we use here. So generally steel, say 410, 440, 540, it is ultimate tensile strength, not the yield strength. So that is how the notation, they use for steel. And of course, nowadays, what is a new thing in the market nowadays? In steel, say. So these are all very old, this mild steel and other things. But nowadays, what is the booming thing in steel? So what is the new material in steel which has come up in the markets nowadays,
Stainless steel.
Stainless steel. Now people have started construction also. See, what is the advantage of stainless steel? Stainless steel we use in cooking actually, okay? In your house, all the vessels, say. So they add this chromium. So once you add chromium, say, then there is no rusting yet, rusting at all. So, and of course, it was very expensive, our cooking, you followed it, stainless steel, pressure cookers and other things also. But now Tata Steel, JSW Steel, so as I told you, right, our steel designs is controlled by this manufacturers. See, tomorrow, if they doesn't produce mild steels, if they say, you have to use this one, so you should use this itself. So you are controlled by these people itself. So now many companies, you know, they have started this stainless steel also. Now they are saying our IS 800, say, it is depending on mild steel. But now these people say that, you know, you build a code for the stainless steel also. So this is some structure, I think somewhere in Europe or somewhere, stainless steel structure. But now people have started using stainless steel columns, stainless steel, this itself, and their strength is very high. You can see here, ultimate tensile strength. So SS316, SS stands for, stainless steel. Fe stands for mild steel, okay? So now for mild steel, what was tensile strength? Ultimate tensile strength we have seen. 410, like that we had 440, 540, 590. But now for stainless steel, so you can see its ultimate tensile strength is, 515. And very high, stainless steel has very high strength. And another, and the main advantage of stainless steel is no, rusting. So this you can avoid. So maybe after 10 years, say, already people have started, maybe, we may have the stainless steel also, in the markets, in the shops, stainless steel I section, angle section. Of course, they are already available in the market. They are a little bit expensive, but maybe we don't know the steel company. Say later on, they may produce in bulk. If they reduce the price, say, then people will start using this stainless steel also in our constructions. Okay. But anyway, as far as this course is concerned, we are not going to discuss stainless steel. Our thing is essentially this Fe 410. This only we'll be using it, mild steel only. Okay. And now that what is the main advantages of our steel? So the main advantage, as already why we have to use steel, this is, high strength per unit weight. This is the main guiding, the phenomenon. So if you compare structural steels with others like, concrete, brick, aluminium and other things also. So you can see its unit weight, you followed, right? Maybe the next one you can see here. So mass of mild steel, say, some 7850 kg per meter cube. Concrete is this, and wood is, you followed, right, 290 to 900. And if you compare their strength, so compressive strength is, 250. Tensile strength is also 250. Shear strength, say, is 144. But concrete, say, it is very, very, small when you compare with wood, or if you compare with masonry, if you compare with many other materials, say. So our steel is, has, better, you followed, right, this quantities. Even Young's modulus, the, the elasticity, the modulus of elasticity is also very high compared to concrete and other materials itself. And Poisson's ratio for steel is, 0.3, whereas for concrete, it is, 0.2 itself, okay? So this is why the advantage, why we use steel in our constructions. So it has a high strength per unit weight, that drives, this steel itself. Now, another thing, as already I told you, the most important property of mild steel is, this ductility. So this is the most, you followed it, the important thing with steel. Of course, only mild steel only. If you go for cast iron and others, they are all brittle material like concrete itself. So mild steel is ductile. So you know, right? So for concrete, if you see the stress strain diagrams, a brittle material, you will see like this, and it suddenly, it fails. But steel, say, you can see this type of, like this, and you have a nice, the ductility. So you can see this entire, you followed it, it gives sufficient warning. And, it is very advantageous in construction. So brittle material failure will be sudden, no warning. If it is moderate ductile, say, so you will see slowly. But if it is very ductile, say, it becomes, say, like this. So that has some advantages, the ductility, you see, visibility. And of course, later we will see weldability. Then when it is subjected to dynamic loads, say, it will have a lot of other advantages are there. So the ductility is the one which is main advantage of the steel when you compare it to concrete, masonry, rocks, or whatever other building materials. So this is a typical, a stress strain curve of this one. I will just show you one nice YouTube video is there. So how the stress strain curve say. You are able to see?
Yes, sir.
So you can, this video is available online. You can just see it in Google. Okay, so tensile, so this is a steel, how they do this, tensile. So this is a steel specimen. So you have gauge length, right, how to test the steel. So there is a gauge length, 5.65 square root of A0 is there. You have to take that much length if D is a diameter, say. So you can't take whatever you like, okay? There are some specifications are there as per the ASTM, our standards. So this is a tensile test, he does. So this is how, you know, they mount the specimen, and then you see they simply apply the tensile strength. So now once you have started, say, so you plot, you know, the force versus deformation or stress versus strain, you know, the graph looks like this. Now you can see here, okay. So generally everything for us starts with 0, 0, but in, when you are doing experiments, say, you will not get this portion, okay. So it starts at some place. So as you keep on increasing the load, you know, how it goes away, you can see. You can even while there is a audio also. So you can see this necking here, you know, so this place, how it fails. So as you keep on, so the area decreases and suddenly, you know, it breaks this steel specimen. So this is how, you know, the tensile test, say, of a steel specimen, you see, looks like. So this is how you followed, right? So this stress strain curve of, you know, this low carbon steel or mild steel, so it looks, you know, something like this, okay? So can anybody tell what is this? Or maybe, you know. So you would have, you are able to see, right?
Yes, sir.
So now can anybody tell us what is the this one? This portion. So it has come to that same, that YouTube video also had something. So it starts increasing, then after that it remains constant actual, and then suddenly it starts increasing, and then the necking happens and goes down. So this anyway is engineering stress. This is a true stress. You know, right? What is the definition between engineering stress and true stress? What is engineering stress?
So engineering stress is assuming that the cross-sectional area is the same even while necking, and true stress is when you account for the change in area.
Yes, yes, excellent. Okay, so now what is this portion, you tell me? Yield stress is remaining constant. What does it tell you? What is that? What is the important thing, that one? You would have studied in your mechanics of materials also. So what does this correspond to? This constant yield stress. You would have seen in the YouTube video also. What is that? What is that? You know, you have studied, right? What is that? Why yield stress remains constant? What do you call that phenomena? Even in that YouTube, which one?
Plastic deformation.
Elastic deforming. Plastic deformation.
Strain hardening.
No, that is not strain hardening. Strain hardening is this portion. You followed, right? But what is this portion? Yield stress is remaining constant. What is the technical term we use? Luders bands. Have you studied this one? So this we call as, you know, the yield stress becomes constant because the whole specimen cannot go to plastic range suddenly. You followed it. It will not yield. one portion yields, then slowly this yield portion, you see the full specimen comes up. That's what we call as the Luders band, actually. Very, very, of course, it's a plastic, that is a fine, but the technical term is, you see, Luders band. Okay, so I will stop here. So anyway, you can watch in Google and you can find out for our next class itself. Okay. You can watch that YouTube video, you know, it's a very nice video, and you will, they will explain you all the details of this itself. Okay.